In order to understand why the web browser is the internet's gift to artists, by which I mean in order for us to really take advantage of what it's got to offer us, we need to understand where browsers came from and the deeply intermingled ideas of all the radical thinkers who influenced it. Meanwhile, a team of some of my favorite computer people of all time, known as the Learning Research Group, formed at Xerox PARC. Alan Kay, Adele Goldberg, Dan Ingalls, and others envisioned a world where computers would be very personal machines that you could carry around in your book bag. These Dynabooks, as they called them, wouldn't be your typical terminal. It would be a dynamic medium for creative thought. It would be graphical. You'd use a mouse, you didn't have to know how to program or even what you wanted to do with the computer because the system itself would be a place to learn and explore. The Xerox PARC folks didn't just write about these ideas, they actually produced that system and called it Smalltalk. One of the first object-oriented programming languages and the first real graphical user interface.
In terms of techniques for accessing information, a key presentation technique we've used is to divide up the display screen into rectangular areas or parts that people like to call windows. And so there are windows onto information. The primary kind of window that we like to talk about is one that we call a browser. We do this because too often we think of computers as being very precise machines in which you have to precisely say, I want this or that, and you get it back, exactly what you asked for. But the nice quality of a library is that you can walk around looking for something specific, but as you're doing it, you find other things. And that's what browsing is all about.
The browser was a curiosity-driven interface. Multiple windows, copy-paste, small incremental changes. These are all commonplace now, but it wasn't how people used computers back then. One day, though she warned her superiors that it would be a bad idea, Adele Goldberg was forced to share all the details about their new system with a now infamous visitor to Xerox PARC, Steve Jobs, who would later quickly borrow many of their new concepts, as would Bill Gates, to make the first commercially available home computers with graphical user interfaces. They, of course, only borrowed all the ideas which would help them brand the computer as a friendly sort of household appliance for consumers, but they would leave out some of the most important ideas, like the fact that the graphical user interface wasn't meant to obfuscate code, to hide it from the user like it was used in Windows and Mac. It was meant to augment the code, to help you program. Smalltalk was first and foremost a creative coding environment. Apple and Windows would also lose sight of the new metamedia concept. Instead, they would generally imitate old media. Movies, music, and books would eventually just become MOVs, MP3s, and PDFs on the computer. Not all that different from their analog counterparts. In contrast, for Kay and Goldberg, the computer was a new active medium, which could respond to queries and experiments, so that the message may involve the learner in a two-way conversation. This property has never been available before except through the medium of an individual teacher. We think the implications are vast and compelling. A new kind of medium would have been created, a meta-medium, whose content would be a wide range of already existing and not yet invented media. But I would be remiss not to mention one of the web browser's biggest influences, arguably one of the most radical computer thinkers of all time, right up there with Ada Lovelace, Ted Nelson. While Smalltalk was being developed, Nelson was working on another piece of software called Xanadu, a program so novel it introduced a whole set of new ideas into the computer world, most notably hypertext. These days, when we hear hypertext, we probably immediately think of the internet, but these weren't as related at the time. Nelson's hypertext, or hypermedia, idea was about the computer as a space for what he referred to as a generalized media format, which was a lot like Kay and Goldberg's metamedia. Xanadu wasn't a programming environment like Smalltalk, but like Smalltalk, it was about framing the computer as a tool for augmenting our thinking, as a friendly space for discovery, where the user was both a reader and a writer, rather than simply a consumer of a new high-tech household appliance. Influenced by earlier thinkers, most notably Vannevar Bush, Ted Nelson's Xanadu, like Smalltalk, was a system for exploring. Before the web, we generally organized information sequentially. We put things into categories, indexed them numerically and alphabetically. Xanadu wouldn't be a collection of discrete books indexed in a card catalog. It would be a mashup of all human knowledge. You could be reading an article which had embedded in it, or more accurately, transcluded into it, another piece of media which you could click on and follow back to its original source, which itself would have another piece of media you could click on and follow back to its original source. With each click, you'd make an associative jump to another piece of content. Navigating Xanadu had more in common with the way we may think, jumping from thought to associated thought, than the way we might typically organize information. With help from his collaborators Robert Kaliu and Nicola Pello, Tim Berners-Lee realized that if you took hypertext and connected it to the internet, both of these things were going to blow up. Together, in and around 1990, they invented the World Wide Web. Tim Berners-Lee created a protocol which would bring hypermedia documents to the internet, HTTP, or Hypertext Transfer Protocol. He also defined a format for structuring these hypertext documents called HTML, Hypertext Markup Language, a simple metamedia document structure that could be text, images, later video and audio, and all forms of interactive media all at the same time, as in all this stuff in the same type of file. And lastly, he created an addressing scheme for finding these HTML documents online, which he describes as the most fundamental innovation of the web, the URI or URL. And so that's the web. The web isn't a collection of websites necessarily, nor any particular browser or server. It's less a specific thing and more a way of doing things. Quote, what was often difficult for people to understand about the design was that there was nothing else beyond URIs, HTTP, and HTML. There was no central computer controlling the web, no single network on which these protocols worked, nor even an organization anywhere that ran the web. The web was not a physical thing that existed in a certain place. It was a space in which information could exist. And Berners-Lee took special care to design it in such a way as to allow for the widest degree of participation possible.